Hey, good morning, Open Bible Church. We are so glad that we can be in your living rooms again this morning. We're so grateful. We think it's a real piece of God's grace that we can be a part of your life in this way and through technology. We're thankful. And we just pray and hope that this whole service will be an evidence of His grace, will be a means of His grace to you as you are fed on His word and prayer and worship. And we trust that God's blessing would be upon you. We really miss you. We want you to know that. We have great desire to be with you and hope that it's not too much longer. With that in mind, a couple of updates from our church family that we miss so much.
Yes, birthdays and anniversaries. We look forward to this each week. And we have a pretty significant birthday. You said we're not allowed to say anything about ages, right?
No ages.
Victor Nickerson had an important birthday. So happy birthday to
you, Victor. How significant was it?
It's substantial.
It's pretty substantial.
Happy birthday.
Happy birthday, Victor.
As well, anniversaries, Tony and Jeanette. So happy anniversary to you guys. I hope you had a great time together. Reminder to you as well that we're continuing with our Sunday evening prayer gatherings, the Zoom meetings. And I think a lot of you are bit by bit getting the hang of Zoom. And hopefully we'll be able to have everybody who wants to be there to get on there with us and pray with us tonight, 6 p.m. The email has been sent with the link and you can click on that and follow it and we can pray together tonight.
Yeah, we're also using Zoom to do our life groups, which I'll be honest, I was pretty overwhelmed when we saw the response of our church family. I think there's a real desire for community at our church, and it's great to see that. I was overwhelmed because I quite honestly expected maybe 6 or 8 people would love to probably get together, and we'll have maybe have a group here or there. But over 40 people, kind of an overwhelming response to me. So we have you in a couple of groups. If you're not a part of one of those groups, we'd love for you to do that study still with us as a church family. Go to Right Now Media. If you don't have Right Now Media, you can talk to us about that. We'll get you hooked up. But if you go on Right Now Media, it's Psalm 23 by Matt Chandler, and it's a real good study. We think you'll be encouraged by it. Answer the questions. There's a free study guide attached with that, and you can watch the video, answer the questions, and again, have your soul ministered to by one of the most precious and familiar psalms in all of the Word. So we just commend that to you. And just speaking of our church family, keep checking in on each other. Keep making those phone calls and send the texts and make sure everyone's doing okay. I mean, we're actively doing that. I thank you for checking in with us. I know you've called us and Facebooked us and asked us so many times, how you guys doing? How you guys make? Is there anything you need? And it just makes you feel like you're a part of a community and that people are really taking care of each other. So keep up the good work in that regard. Let's make sure we don't leave anybody out. Do your best to think about and consider and pray for as many as you can in these days.
We're going to read from a psalm to prepare our hearts for our worship time together. Psalm 96. So let's read this together. Oh, sing to the Lord a new song. Sing to the Lord, all the earth. Sing to the Lord, bless His name. Proclaim the good news of His salvation from day to day. Declare His glory among the nations, His wonders among all peoples. For the Lord is great and greatly to be praised. He is to be feared above all gods. For all the gods of the peoples are idols, but the Lord made the heavens. Honor and majesty are before Him. Strength and beauty are in His sanctuary. Give to the Lord, O families of the peoples. Give to the Lord glory and strength. Give to the Lord the glory due His name. Bring an offering and come into His courts. O worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. Tremble before Him, all the earth. Say among the nations, the Lord reigns. The world also is firmly established. It shall not be moved. He shall judge the peoples righteously. Let the heavens rejoice and let the earth be glad. Let the sea roar and all its fullness. Let the field be joyful and all that is in it. Then all the trees of the woods will rejoice before the Lord. For He is coming. For He is coming to judge the earth. He shall judge the world with righteousness and the peoples with his truth. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you that this psalm is true. It's not just what someone felt about you, but it is true about you. That you are deserving of our worship, you are deserving of our praise, the focus of our minds and our hearts, that our wills would be turned towards you. You're deserving of that. You are deserving of our offering of thanksgiving. You're deserving of our trust. You're deserving of our humility. And certainly you're deserving of our song. And so, Father, I pray that as we move into praise and worship and thanksgiving, that we would humbly honor you in such a way because you are worthy of it. We thank you. We praise you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. One of the other things we just wanted to transition with here, we want to take care of our missionaries and make sure that they're talked about during these days as well. We often are so focused on ourselves. We want to make sure we take care of others as well around the world. And our church for the last couple of years has partnered with Servant's Heart Ministry and Danica's Dream. We've done the Change for Change. You've seen the big baby bottles in here, and we filled them up with loose change and offered that to that ministry. And we just wanted to give you a little update on that. And so check out this video. There's a new way to be able to give to that since we're not here and we can't put change into a baby bottle. There's something different that you can do and partner with them this year. So let's check that out now.
Now it's time for your No Time newsletter. Today on the fourth episode of Servant's Heart's No Time newsletter, we have Jenny Polanco, the director of our pregnancy center. Jenny, welcome.
Thanks. It's good to be here.
Can you briefly tell everyone what the purpose of the pregnancy center is?
Yes. Danica's Dream is a program-based education. We teach the moms how to take care of themselves and their baby and what is God's plan is for them.
I'm curious, how has the current COVID-19 crisis affected what is happening at the pregnancy center?
The limit contact with them because we don't want to the virus spread, and we send the lesson to the client. We are doing some videos and we send to them to have a conversation through WhatsApp. It has been a little difficult for the Dominican families, but for the Haitian, it's very hard because it doesn't have any program for them.
Okay, so what are we doing at this time to help them out?
We decide to pay for 2 weeks of food for them. So in this way, we will helping them to survive when they are available to return to work. So,
you know, for you guys at home, this time of year, we do our annual Change for Change fundraiser. It goes from Mother's Day to Father's Day in June. So what you don't know is that the fundraiser actually provides almost half of our budget to support the pregnancy center and the work that Jenny and the staff is doing. This year, we're actually going to move it online. We're calling it $1 a day in May. And we're hoping that you will continue to partner with us and to help Jenny and her staff the work that they're doing. So Jenny, I really appreciate your time today. Make sure you say thank you, especially to your staff and the people that are working every day, keeping the program going and helping the moms and their babies. So thank you.
Thank you for allowing us to do that in the ministry.
Thank you. I really appreciate that. God bless.
God bless you too.
Desire will burn our hearts with truth. Oh. reason we're here. You're the reason we're singing. Open up the heavens. We want to see you. Open up the floodgates. The mighty river flowing from your heart, filling every part of our praise. Your presence in this place, your glory on our face. We're looking to the sky, descending like a cloud. You're standing with us now, Lord, unveil our eyes. You're the reason we're here. You're the reason we're singing. Your power, show us your glory, Lord. Show us your glory. Show us your power. Show us your glory, Lord.
Last week, we had a great time, the beginning of our worship service, singing songs that remind us that Christ is King on the throne and how that gives us comfort and hope in our times, challenging times that we're in right now of struggling and suffering and loss. But that truth of Christ on the throne also helps to realign ourselves with God for who He is, right? Not just our buddy, not our equal, not even just a little bit above us, but our King. Above and beyond and separate, and set apart and holy in all ways. And that truth about God humbles us, doesn't it? And prepares our hearts to truly worship Him. And so we're going to sing a few songs again that remind us of God on the throne and allow us and bring us into that place of humble worship. But before we do that, I want to read a prayer. It's not something that we do very often, but the great words in this prayer that I hope will be a reflection and a truth from our hearts. Feel free to read along and pray along. Holy Father, forgive us. Though you should guide us, we inform ourselves. Though you should rule us, we control ourselves. Though you should fulfill us, we console ourselves. For we think your truth is too high, and your will too hard, your power too remote, your love too free, but they are not. And without them, we are of all people most miserable. Heal our confused mind with your word.
Heal our troubled conscience with your love. Heal our anxious hearts with your peace. All for the sake of your Son, who loved us and gave himself for us. Amen.
Wash me in your cleanse. Together. Father, we praise you for this truth, the worthiness of Jesus Christ, the worthiness. He deserves our meeting together, our singing of praises for all of these years, for the rest of our lives to proclaim that he is worthy of all that we can give, because of all that he has given, because of all that he is. We praise you for Christ, our King. We praise you for the hope that that gives us in our struggles and suffering day to day. And we praise you that this helps us to know where we belong, at the feet of Jesus Christ, giving him glory and praise. And we want to humbly listen to your word this morning. We want to humbly hear what you have to say to us with thankfulness that you have given us your word. So we can know who you are, we can know who we are, we can know where we belong in our world. And we pray, Father, that we would humbly listen and obey. We give you the praise in Jesus' name. Amen.
Well, if you have your Bibles, I'd love if you would turn with me to 1 Peter chapter 2, and verse 13 is where we're going to begin on our text. The very first word is the word therefore. Therefore always looks backwards to what was previously written. And as the catchphrase goes, when you read the word therefore, you always look back to see what therefore was there for. And so if we look backwards to last Sunday, we're standing in the mudroom, the entryway to the house that's going to unfold over the next few weeks. And verse 11, verse 12 that we studied the last couple of weeks, both abstain from evil and do good. And now we're going to start entering into some of those rooms of that house to explore the areas where abstaining from evil and doing good bears itself out in real life situations. And so as we enter into the very first room, the room of human government today, our obligation as Christians to submit and to obey human government, submission is going to actually be the theme over the next few weeks for us. Submit to government today, submit to masters next week, wives, submit to husbands down the road. And while the subject of submission is always difficult, I think this particular room, submission to government, is going to be harder for some than others to follow, to explore. For some, following the rules, let's be honest, it's actually kind of fun for them. Some people love rules. They love rules so much they wish there were actually more of them to follow. I hope they keep the arrows in the grocery stores for years to come. I just love following the arrows in the stores. In every home, there's going to be people who are rule makers and rule breakers. In every church, there are rule makers and rule breakers. In every society, every country, there are rule makers and there are rule breakers, like at heart. There will be a tendency toward rules or in opposition to them. What do we call someone who lives in opposition to the rules? We call them a rebel. Rule keepers love rules. They love when everybody else around them keeps rules. So rule keepers and rebels, they do not get along so well. They're like as well as oil and water. They just don't mix. When they're in the grocery store right now, you can pick them out, can't you? The rule keeper wants everybody to distance themselves. They wait in line. They wait for you to pick out your tomato sauce or your cereal, and they will not even pass you. They'll stick in line, they're following the arrows and 2 meters apart, and they want everyone else to do the same. But you get a rule breaker, a rebel in a grocery store, and they see that arrow moving this way, and what do they want to do? They want to moonwalk in the other direction. That's how the opposites work in our even society. Now, there could be a third category of person, which I would like to kind of place myself in. And I wouldn't say that I love rules or hate rules. I just like rules that make sense to me. Anyone with me? I like a rule as much as anybody else, as long as I think it makes sense, as long as it doesn't keep me from being able to do what I want to do or like to do. If I can see the benefit of it, if I feel like it would serve my purposes or my good, write it up, make it law, give it a fitting punishment if it's not adhered to and complied with, and enforce it. I'm pro-law, I'm pro-police, I'm pro-justice, I'm pro-court, pro-law, I'm pro-punishment. I see all of those things in God's good order, His design for authority, whether it's in the family or in the school or in the church or in general society. But I have to say, moment of honesty here, I'm also at this present time during this pandemic, I'm the guy going, man, that's just so stupid. What's the difference between 5 people and 7 people? I go to the store, there's 100 people there. I'm the guy going, work from home? What, That's not going to work. It's just going to make it harder to communicate and get stuff done around here. I'm the guy going, no fishing? Seriously? No hiking on a trail by yourself or with people from your own household? Wait, I can walk on this trail. I can bike on this trail. I can't go ATVing on that same trail. I mean, yeah, this message, I will be honest, this message has been super difficult for me to study out and now to preach for some pretty obvious reasons. We're going to read the text anyway because it speaks so relevantly to our situation right now. Read it first, then explore it. 1 Peter 2, verse 13, therefore, submit yourselves to every ordinance of man for the Lord's sake, whether to the king as supreme or to governors, as to those who are sent by him for the punishment of evildoers and for the praise of those who do good. For this is the will of God, that by doing good you may put to silence the ignorance of foolish men, as free, yet not using liberty as a cloak for vice, but as bondservants of God, honor all people, love the brotherhood, fear God, honor the king. A few points for you this morning. Number one, the meaning of submission. They're all in regards to submission. That's the main point here, submission. Submit. Don't get the picture in your mind of some MMA fighter, doing a rear naked choke on somebody. And you know, this is not a tap out thing. This is the Greek word. We've studied it many times in the past, hupotasso, and made up of two Greek words. Tasso means to arrange or place in order or sequence. And hupo means under. So submit simply means to place under, to arrange under, to order under. In this case, it's the idea of placing yourself under another voluntarily for the benefit of all. It's a military term originally, so troops were to fall in line, fall in rank, place themselves under the authority that ranks above them. It means that we are to set aside personal privileges, our personal desires, our personal rights, so that the system can work properly and decently and orderly. That's the meaning of the word submission that will flow through this week and the next several weeks. Secondly, what is the extent of our submission? It says in verse 12, 13 rather, therefore submit yourselves to every ordinance of man. Ordinance could be translated foundation or institution, but literally it's the word creation. Every human creation, who is the creator? God is. So as God creates human government and human authority, we have to understand that this is God's idea, his creation. Everywhere where there is authority, right from the home, family, order, mom, dad, children, all the way through and including government to the highest level. It says here, to the king as supreme at the end of verse 13. The king, supreme, high order. Paul actually writes to the Philippians in chapter 2 and verse 3, and he says, let nothing be done through selfish ambition or conceit, but in lowliness of mind, let each of us, esteem others better than himself. And the word better that he uses is the same word that Peter uses here for the word supreme. To count others superior or supreme to yourself. And there is a sense that every Christian's default disposition ought not to be, pay attention to me. I'm your superior. You ought to think highly of me. No, it ought to rather be, I regard you as higher, more significant, above me. You may not have education or money or status, and I may have all of those things, but my default disposition as a follower of Jesus Christ ought to be, I'm here to serve you. You up, me down. And I think it's really important to note that the Roman Empire in Peter's day was not a benevolent monarchy. It was a horrific dictatorship ruled by the insane Nero, who just so happened to be known for his hatred and cruelty, particularly towards Christians. In fact, many of the recipients of Peter's letter would have suffered direct persecution under his leadership. Even more certainly would in the future. The bodies of some of their friends and loved ones had bloodied the sands of the Roman Colosseum. Their corpses had been soaked in oil and lit on fire to act as garden lights in Nero's parties. That's the king that Peter is referring to. Every ordinance, even him, Nero. For us, it's a man by the name of Justin Trudeau and a liberal government here in Canada. Or two governors, he goes on to write in the beginning of verse 14. That would be anybody underneath of that king, in premiers, mayors, local and municipal authorities, Department of Natural Resources, Lands and Forest, Environment, the CRA, the police, so on and so forth. In Peter's day, men like Pontius Pilate, Felix, Festus come to mind. In our day, Stephen McNeil, David Mitchell, Carolyn Bolivar Getson, Dr. Robert Strang, and others. Do we really have it so bad when compared to some of the names in Peter's day? Matthew 22 and verse 21 says, "Render therefore to Caesar's the things that are Caesar's." 1 Timothy 2, 1 says, "Therefore I exhort first of all that supplications, prayers, intercessions, and giving of thanks be made for all men, for kings, and all who are in authority, that we may lead a quiet and peaceable life in all godliness and reverence. For this is good and acceptable in the sight of God our Savior." Are you praying for them? Titus 3, verse 1 and 2 says, "Remind them to be subject to rulers and authorities, to obey, to be ready for every good work, to speak evil of no one, to be peaceable, gentle, showing all humility to all men." Nowhere in Scripture are we told to rise up against the government, to mock and make fun of its leaders, to resist or overthrow. The word is always submit. It says in verse 14, "As to those who are sent by him for the punishment of evildoers, and for the praise of those who do good." This text sounds awfully familiar to what Paul writes in Romans 13. Let me read it. In verse 1, it says, "Let every soul be subject to the governing authorities. For there is no authority except from God." He created it. "And the authorities that exist are appointed by God. Therefore, whoever resists the authority resists the ordinance of God. And those who resist bring judgment on themselves, for rulers are not a terror to good works, but to evil. Do you want to be unafraid of the authority? Do what is good, and you will have praise from the same, for he is God's minister to you for good. But if you do evil, be afraid, for he does not bear the sword in vain, for he is God's minister, an avenger to execute wrath on him who practices evil." It's one of the purposes of human government. "Therefore, you must be subject, not only because of wrath, but also for conscience' sake. For because of this, you also pay taxes, for they are God's ministers, attending continually to this very thing. Render therefore to all their due, taxes to whom taxes are due, customs to whom customs, fear to whom fear, honor to whom honor." So the role of human government is to restrain evil, maintain law and order, and then to promote the good and welfare of human life. And when the government fails to do that, when the government starts to punish those who do good and praise those who do evil, then we've got some problems, for sure. We've got conflicts that arise and tensions within humanity. And when a government goes totally corrupt and demands that Christians then therefore do things that are in direct opposition to God's word, then I would say that there is also this category. not directly in this text in 1 Peter 2, but within the confines of God's word, is the limits of submission. Now, this is not to be overused, certainly. This is not a category of things for things that you don't like. This is strictly for situations where our government demands that we do some things that are in direct opposition to God's word. For example, in Acts chapter 4, the government told Peter and John, you can no longer preach the good news of Jesus Christ. And in verse 19, they responded, whether it is right in the sight of God to listen to you more than to God, you judge. For we cannot but speak the things which we have seen and heard. Acts chapter 5, the same thing happens. Did we not strictly command you not to teach in this name? And look, you have filled Jerusalem with your doctrine. Peter replies, we ought to obey God rather than men. Daniel was told, listen, you don't pray to anyone else. You don't ask God for anything. You ask the king for 30 days or you're going to be thrown into the lion's den. And what is Daniel going to do? What's he going to do? Well, he's going to go home and he's going to go upstairs and he's going to open his window so everyone can see him and everyone can hear him. I actually think he's praying out loud. How else do they know? And he bows down and he begins to what? To pray. I'm not going to stop praying. God says, pray. I'm going to pray. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego were told to bow down and worship a giant golden statue we likely made in the image of the king. And when music played, you better bow down. You better worship, boys. You risk being thrown into a fiery furnace. Those three young men stood tall, refused to worship any other God but the one true God. Now, what I would say to you is, save your fight for something that really matters. Abortion, sanctity of human life, the proclamation of the gospel. Not whether or not you can go visit your mom right now. And it won't always be clear. Sometimes it'll be a conviction issue. And there are even things right now that we have to wade through in our society and render convictions on whether or not we are going to call someone by a certain pronoun, whether we bake a cake or do the flowers for same-sex weddings, whether we are going to spank our children or not, or protest outside of abortion clinics. These are real life issues that Christians are facing. Now, these are the exceptions because the rule is submission. Whenever possible, we render to Caesar the coin of civil obedience. We pray for those in authority. We pay our taxes. We obey the laws of the land. We live honorably under the domain of earthly, elected, appointed officials. And if the government ever comes to the place where it tells us that we can no longer preach the gospel or the whole counsel of God, now I just hope that maybe you'll set aside a little fund to bail me out of prison. But if they say, listen, guys, we need you to shut down your worship services because there's this global pandemic and for the safety and protection of vulnerable people in our society for a period of time, would you do this? I believe it would be very sinful to violate that. Next, number four, look at the purpose of submission. Why do I do this? Why do I place myself voluntarily over leaders that I don't agree with, I think maybe even are corrupt in perhaps certain places in this world? Why would I do this? Well, listen, first of all, I would say, if you're looking for a perfect human government, you will never find it. Why? Because all government is made up of human beings, and every human being is fallen, and we are all selfish and motivated by greed and self-promotion and our egos. And while some governments are certainly better than other governments, there is no perfect human government. That is why Christians wait so attentively for the return of Jesus Christ to be our perfect King. But until then, our perfect King asks us for this, to submit to imperfect governments. For my sake. Do you see that there in verse 13? Therefore, submit yourselves to every ordinance of man for the Lord's sake. Verse 15 says, for this is the will of God. Later on, as bondservants of God. Fear, last verse, verse 17, fear God. Do you see how incredibly God-centered this is? He is the reason that we would do this. It's for God, for His sake. Listen, if Jesus showed up in your living room this morning and asked you personally, listen, God, would you do this for me? Would you submit for my sake? Or would you refuse? That's what this is. This is very personal. It's from the Lord. Do this for my sake. So that's purpose number one, for the sake of the Lord. But secondly, notice, for the silence of foolish men. Verse 15 says, for this is the will of God, that by doing good, you may put to silence the ignorance of foolish men. Silence is actually the word used for muzzle. They will literally be held speechless, without a word. It's like gagging someone so they cannot respond. Notice these men are ignorant. This is not just that they don't know the truth or have been never told the truth. It's the person who, the sense is that willfully ignores or rejects the truth that they have been told. And this classifies them then, therefore, as a foolish person, someone senseless, without reason. You just can't reason with them. They don't have the ability to form sensible, cogent arguments. It's very interesting to me right now that there is an increasing pressure and protest against the field hospital that was set up by Samaritan's Purse in the heart of New York City's Central Park, where out of the goodness of their own hearts, people have, doctors, nurses, medical staff have been, teams have been coming together, placing themselves in great risk for treating the coronavirus-ravaged city and saving I don't know how many lives. Why do some want that torn down? It's because of Samaritan Purse's stance on marriage, of all things. Samaritan Purse believes that marriage is between one man and one woman for a lifetime. Not unlike us. You see, it's very foolish. It's unreasonable. It's nonsensical. I told you last week some of the rumors that were flying around about Christians in those days, Peter's days, they were cannibals, they were rebels, they were sexually deviant. All of that is ignorance, willful ignorance. They just wanted to find something to hate Christians for. And so instead of actually interacting with them, asking legitimate questions, they just turned to slander and rumors and speculation. They meet in secret. What's with them? What are they up to? Are they going to try and overtake us? And I wonder what they do behind those closed doors. I bet it's really sick. Peter says, when they do that to you, do not use words, use life to change their minds. Verse 12 says that they're going to speak evil against us as evildoers. And they do, even today, mostly because of our stance on certain issues. You're hateful, you're bigots, you're intolerant. Listen, do not become angry and strike back. Just increase and intensify your good works. By submitting to the civil authorities, we muzzle any rumors that we're this maverick group, that we do as we please. Listen, we gain nothing by rebelling against civil authorities. In fact, I would say that we lose so much in so many ways when we do that. I think of And I really don't want to target any particular thing or place that's going on right now, but the church that comes to mind in Ontario that's holding drive-in services the last 2 or 3 weeks against the law, churches in Louisiana and Florida, these pastors taunting, flaunting themselves, just kind of promoting, we're going to do what we want to do. Listen, you might think it's worth fighting for. But all you're doing is throwing wood on the fire that's already set ablaze in our volatile anti-Christian world. Instead of muzzling the world's criticism of us, you're putting words for them in their mouths to speak against us. You're making it very easy for them to speak of us as evildoers. You're just giving them ammunition. There goes the Christian again, just does whatever he wants to do. Brothers and sisters, these things ought not to be so. Submission to authority is the strongest apologetic against the view that Christians are always disturbers, always have their own agenda, always up to no good, that they govern themselves. They only exist for themselves. Our goodness will be the strongest apologetic for the gospel. Good works silence false accusations, Peter says. We ought to be throwing ourselves, therefore, into good works. Submission to even government is a great apologetic for the gospel. I think this lesson was probably learned in a very hard way by Peter. On the night that Jesus was arrested in the garden, betrayed by Judas, I mean, Peter came out swinging that night. He brought his sword to do some damage. Cut off Malchus's ear, the guard's ear. But here, in 1 Peter, decades later, the much wiser Peter, having been rebuked on that night by the Lord, I think would say to us today, put your swords away. Those kind of weapons have no effectiveness here. We have different weapons now. Namely, the weapon of good works that will silence, muzzle the critic, the foolish person. Now, Peter actually raises for us an objection to submission. In verse 16, it says, as free. Here's the objection. Listen. I'm a free creature. I'm free. I can do whatever I want. Yeah, you are free. You're free from a lot of things in Christ. You're free from guilt because our sins have been graciously forgiven by God. Amen. We're free, we're set free from the impossible obligation of attempting to earn favor with God through my own actions. You're free from the dominating effects and power of sin in your own life because of the gospel. That's the kind of freedom that he's talking. He's not talking you have freedom of choice. He's not talking you can do whatever you want, whatever comes naturally to you in your flesh, go ahead and do it. This is a freedom that comes to do God's will, to live in the light, to obey God's law. You used to be slaves to another master, to sin, but now you are free, free to do what God wants you to do. Notice it says, as free, yet not using liberty as a cloak for vice, but as bondservants of God. Yet not using liberty as a cloak for vice, evil, wickedness. Cloak means covering like a veil or a mask. The idea is, don't say, I'm free, I can do whatever I want, and then go do whatever you want, evil, wicked things. Why? Because we are bondservants of God. The Greek word bondservant there is doulos, literally means we are slaves of God. In 1 Corinthians 7, Paul writes in verse 22, for he who is called in the Lord while a slave is the Lord's freedman. Likewise, he who is called while free is Christ's slave. What that means is you might be a slave to a human master, but you're free to do God's will. or you might be completely free. You might actually be a master of other human beings. But you are always Christ's slave. You're always a slave to another as a Christian, to a different master. We have always had a master. The question is, who is your master? Is sin your master? The flesh, what I want, what Satan wants, is that your master? See, the gospel sets us free, but it doesn't set us free to do what we want. It sets us free so we don't have to serve sin, but we are free to serve Christ. He is our master, and a good master he is. Martin Luther wrote a long time ago, a Christian is a perfectly free lord of all, subject to none. A Christian is a perfectly dutiful servant of all, subject to all. In other words, you don't have to, but you ought to. That's the attitude of the Christian. We don't submit because we necessarily agree. We don't submit because we deeply support all of the rules and codes and regulations. Some of them seem so petty and so restrictive and so nonsensical and even prejudicial at times. Listen, we submit because it is the will of God and we are his slaves. We don't submit to wearing our seatbelt or coming to a full stop at a stop sign or driving the speed limit because you might get a fine if you break those rules. Christians submit to the ordinances of man because we love the Lord, because they are acts of worship. We pay taxes, listen, even if we disagree with the way our money's being spent. Even if it's being spent on things, quite frankly, that even grieve the very heart of God. Like building golden statues that you are going to be told to bow down and worship, or funding abortion clinics, or bailouts of large corporations. You don't have to agree, but you need to remain peaceful, love your enemies, give accurate critique, not just one-sided rants, and remain respectful. I think Peter may have had in mind this experience from his own life in Matthew chapter 17, verse 24. It says, when they had come to Capernaum, those who received the temple tax came to Peter and said, does your teacher not pay the temple tax? He said, yes. And when he had come into the house, Jesus, I love this, anticipated him, saying, what do you think, Simon? From whom do the kings of the earth take customs or taxes? From their sons or from strangers? Peter said to him, from strangers. Jesus said to him, then the sons are, listen, they're what? They're free. I love it. I love it, Jesus. It means we don't have to pay taxes. We're free. We can do what we want. Hold on. Nevertheless, lest we offend them. Go to the sea, cast in a hook, take the fish that comes up first, and when you have opened its mouth, you'll find a piece of money. Take that, give it to them for me and you. Now, first of all, I would say about that text, don't you wish that paying taxes was that easy for you? Honey, just go down, cast down at the lake, and we got enough to pay the taxes. But Jesus' point is crystal clear. We are free, but lest we offend them. And so when we stand in front of a leader who says, you better do what I say or else, you owe me allegiance, you owe me honor and respect, you owe me taxes, you could say, well, technically, I don't owe you anything. I'm a citizen of heaven. But for the Lord's sake, I will. And putting that particular leader, whether it's your boss at work or the highest government official in the land, by name-calling and anger and filthy gestures is not freedom. That is actually bondage to your own ego, your own pride. Freedom is putting him in his place with humility and meekness. when you get the manual at work from your boss and the list of stuff that you got to abide by, we don't go, this is so stupid. I hate all these rules. If you see that something could be done better or changed for the good of the company, there is a way to do that. Humble suggestion. Just got to say that it's becoming more and more clear to me that the brand of quote-unquote Christianity or evangelicalism that is present in the United States right now, this, I don't know if you would call it Republican Christianity, but it's very rapidly turned into, I'm not submitting to anyone. I have my rights. We're not going to let them get away with this. It's abrasive and feisty and angry and confrontational. And I just need to say that this issue is far more a theological issue than you might initially think. This is an issue of trust in a sovereign God, that He is actually in control of all things. When Christians show disgust and a despising of their human leaders, they quickly reveal that they have lost sight of God's sovereignty. Who do you think placed, the New Testament word, Romans 13, is appointed? Who appointed them? Both the good ones and the bad ones. Why do people break the law? Because they crave, because they want more money, because they want that person to get out of their way, or they want to get there quicker, or they want to do what they want to do. James 4 simply says, where do wars and fights come from among you? Do they not come from your desires for pleasure that war in your members? You lust and you do not have. You murder and covet and cannot obtain. You fight and you war your desires. I hate to pick on this, but it's an easy one. Because it probably applies to almost every single one of us. Why do you speed? Well, I don't want to be late. I want to get there on time. Everyone else is going faster than me. I don't like when people pass me. It's not fair. I can't bear to let someone else pass me. That's all ego, desire. The person who's driving their car with the cruise control on, obeying the speed limit, that person might frustrate the life out of you, but they're just sitting back worshiping Jesus. The person who can sit in a traffic jam with patience, which, by the way, is a fruit of the Spirit, that's a beautiful thing. Not honking the horn, shaking the fist, yelling out the window. Lastly, the attitude of submission. Notice the sort of punchy, staccato kind of way he closes this argument in verse 17. Honor all people, love the brotherhood, fear God, honor the king. Notice it's bookended by the word honor. We'll come back to that. What does it say in between? Love the brethren, fear God. Love the brethren. See, honor all people, honor them, but love. I'm going to love the brethren. Agape, unconditional. You before me. I lay myself down for you. Kind of love. There is just such a special kind of love that we have for the brotherhood, the church. Brothers and sisters in Christ. When I heard this week that 6 members of the armed forces went down in a helicopter off the coast of Greece, I was immediately attracted to the one that I found out was a sister in Christ. Her name is Abigail, who actually went to the Regal Heights Baptist Church in Dartmouth. Had scripture on her Facebook page. Why? Why attracted to her? She's my sister in Christ. She's in the brotherhood. It's just a special love for her and her family and that church grieving. And then notice, fear God. This is not a terrified fear that produces some cowering, but a healthy respect, a reverence and admiration, a fear that produces not cowering, but surrender and obedience. And then honor. both. Peter says everyone, and then in case you were tempted to say, oh yeah, I can honor everyone that I like, or everyone that I agree with, or everyone that I find easy to honor, he adds at the end, honor the king, because he knows, I think he knows. It is so hard for us to honor someone or some system that we find ourselves in opposition to so often. Now, obedience is one thing, honor is another. Honor is an attitude. Children are told in the scriptures both to obey their parents in the Lord, for this is right, and to honor their mothers and fathers. And that's not just obedience. This is obedience with a good attitude. How many of you parents at home right now know that a child can obey the order that you give them, but they can do it with a bad attitude? Grumbling, complaining, muttering under their breath as they obey. Listen, obeying the speed limit while criticizing is not full obedience. Every parent wants to move their kids through four stages. The first is just compliance, you know, just pick up your toys. Why? Because I said so, that's why. Just do it. Pick up your toys. The second is better. Pick up your toys, we say to our kids a lot, without complaining. But did you know there's something even better than that? Because even though they don't say the words, there still can be that internal attitude. So I think even better is pick up your toys without being told. There's just something in there. They don't say anything. They don't even have to be told. They just do it. And then lastly, pick up your toys because, I don't know, maybe you want to help. Serve the family. Honor mom and dad in this way. See, there's a progression there. Not just obedience and the attitude that accompanies it. Honor. I'll tell you right now, if Justin Trudeau knocked on my front door and asked to come in, even though I disagree with so much of his policy and his stance on moral issues, I would treat him with utmost respect and honor him. And there is a way, by the way, to do that, that doesn't mean either that I agree with him or a way that doesn't say to the world that I hate him. I just have to say there are some things that I've seen posted online about our country's leaders as of late. And they got to stop. They got to stop, Christian. You can have an opinion. You can even express that opinion. But there is no place for the Christian to insult or name call or demean or directly disobey the scripture that we're studying right here today. Honor the King. God placed them in this office. He appointed them, and we ought to respect that. Honor. Honor, not anger. Not, well, if you're going to talk about us like that, if you're going to make life difficult for us, if you're going to make fun of what we believe, if you're going to think that I'm a fool or an idiot, fine. Just have fun in hell, because I'm going to heaven. Listen, that is not how a Christian thinks. If you're not caused to grieve over the person who calls you and your church a fool, if you don't feel something in your heart for the person who's angry over your stance on a particular issue that you're taking, if you would rather that person go to hell instead of heaven, perhaps you better reevaluate whether that is your own personal destiny. Again, the Spirit of Christ, echoed by Stephen, all of this is shown. I don't have time to get into it. We'll get into it as the weeks progress. But all of this is exemplified by Jesus in verses 21 through 23. Who, when he was reviled, did not revile in return. When he suffered, did not threaten, verse 23. But committed himself to him who judges righteously. Hanging on the cross. Being stoned to death, Jesus and Stephen both uttered, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Forgive them. You know, when this is all over, pandemic, and we look back on our Facebook statuses and our public conversations, interactions with people, let me ask you, what do you think the church is going to be remembered for? What is our church going to be remembered for? Will we be remembered for our fear-mongering, causing panic and anxiety, spreading hyperbolized information, drastic numbers that cause people great fear? Will we, on the other hand, be remembered for our sort of laid-back, casual approach? I don't care what anyone thinks. This is all nonsense. Will we be known and remembered for our failure to follow governing authorities, how we disobeyed all the rules, for our protests, for our suspicion and our conspiracy theories? Or will we be known for being on the front lines of serving and loving and caring? Because let me tell you, listen, the church throughout history, during pandemics and plagues and diseases and famines and crisis and tragedies, has always been known for their love and care and compassion. And how we act during a crisis is a great revealer of where our hearts and minds were before the crisis ever hit. People do not need us sounding off on our government. They need us as a church pointing them to God. The last thing the church needs right now is to become more divided. Well, I think all these rules are a joke. Just let us get back to work. This government, I have my rights, the economy, my job, my income. I get it. Very, very hard, difficult decisions to make. You have this whole other group, even in the church. You better follow the arrows in the stores, one person at a time. Wear a mask, wash your hands, shut the country down as long as it takes. My health, my family, my safety. I'm going to turn everyone in for not following the rules. You have both sides. You have people in the church announcing boldly their positions on both sides, and there are starting to be some dividing lines amongst Christians. I'm not saying you can't have your personal opinions on things, but here's what I would say to you. There is something more important. Honor all people. Love the brotherhood. Fear God. And honor the King. And what should be proclaimed at this time is the peace and the hope that the gospel brings to those who will turn to Him in this crisis. Stop promoting your opinions as the ultimate answer to the problem. Start promoting the real answer, the ultimate answer, Jesus Christ, the righteous. Are our hearts marked by and indicated by our speech and our behavior, marked by submission to God's word, submissive to God-given authority, submissive to every ordinance of man? Or are our hearts marked by our unwillingness to obey, to take advice, to find ways to break the rules, to vent about government, to act like we have all the answers? Listen, the issue is a submission issue, and we're in it right now. This is a pride issue. And while we love to point the finger at others, I think now is a very real time to look inside of our own hearts, where the real problem often lies, where pride and an unruly heart has placed itself on the throne of our own lives. May we, as a Christian people, as a church here living in Bridgewater, Nova Scotia, may we choose rather to live in humility and in graciousness and in meekness. God, help us. We belong to You. We are Your children. We are Your slaves, servants. And we want to do this not because we feel like it, not because we find great joy in it. Many of us find it difficult, perhaps one of the most difficult things in our whole experience as Christians, to honor the King. Lord, we will do it both to silence the critics around us and so that we can do this for Your sake, for Your glory, so that Your name can be proclaimed above all others. And so, God, break the back of my rebellious, prideful heart. And may I first of all order myself under your authority, and as you have placed in that authority, governing human authorities over me. Oh God, break my back to pride there too. May I humbly submit myself to all that you have established and created in this world, in this country, in this province. This is not an easy issue for any of us. And yet, God, we look to you. We look for gospel help here. Break our pride. Break our rebellion. May we submit to you and to that which you have established for us. Give us the grace to do that. Help us, God. Thank you for our church. Thank you for the people that encompasses, all the faces, all the names, all the hearts, all the relationships that we're missing right now while it's being separate. Pray for each one. Give us peace. Put your word and your name and your glory on our lips. May the good works that we do in this crisis overwhelm the criticisms against us. We pray for that in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen.
Take my life and let it be consecrated, Lord, to thee. Take my moments and my days, let them flow in ceaseless praise. Let them flow in ceaseless praise. Take my hands and let them move at the impulse of thy love. Take my feet and let them be swift and beautiful for thee. Swift and beautiful for thee. Silver and my gold, not of my good I withhold. Take my intellect and use every power as thou shalt choose. Every power as thou shalt. Take my will and make it thine, it shall be no longer mine. Take my heart, it is thine own, it shall be thy royal throne, it shall be.
And may that song be the song of our spirit and our heart, even right now, as we think about what we have just heard and encountered in your word. God, we pray that you would seal this truth to our hearts. Make it effective and personal as we have encountered you in your word. And Lord, you've been good to us. You've been kind to us to speak to us, to illumine your scriptures to us. And I pray that as we walk away from this encounter, experience, this worship service in our homes today, God, would you take the message of this whole day, the theme of this service. And Lord, I pray that it would be real to us, that there would be distinctions in our lives because of what you've done in our hearts today, that there would be differences now from yesterday. And so, God, keep on changing us, keep on growing us, keep on sanctifying us so that we truly do follow the example of our Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, in all ways. We thank you for your grace that empowers us and enables us to even live this truth out. So keep working on us, God. We surrender our hearts to you. Take our lives and let them be consecrated, Lord, to thee. We prayed in the strong name of Jesus. Amen. Thank you for joining with us today. God bless you and keep you. And may his face shine upon you and be gracious. Bye for now.